invitation to be here and to share a bit of my experience in the past years on active learning. I also want to congratulate the ECLOSE team for their project and for the outcome that have been presented here in this session, which is very interesting. And all these materials and toolbox, I was talking about this at lunch, that I think that we have a lot of information available, and I think the reason why people don't innovate in teaching is not because they don't have access to information. I think what we need, really need, is time and motivation to get this in practice. So I think all these tools will be very useful. And I'm going to share with you some of our experience here at Portucalense University. So in these next 20 minutes, what I'm going to talk to you about is just a short presentation about my university and who I am and what do I do. Then I will move forward to talk to you about student engagement and learning and how can we approach this. And I'm going to talk to you about PBL, project-based learning, and service learning. I'm not sure, probably most of you are aware of, but mostly project-based learning is more known. And talk to you about some principles and some ideas about them, and then I want to share with you some of the experiences that I have been involved, both in the field of education, which is where I'm from, where I lecture, where my teaching activity is, and also with engineering students, which started with my PhD, which was with in the context of engineering education, and which I think is much relevant for this project. So this is my university. It's a private university located in the north of Portugal, in Porto. And well, I am from the education field. I have a PhD in education sciences and specialization in curriculum development. And I'm an assistant professor at the Department of Psychology and Education. I teach, my teaching activity is mostly related to teacher education. I coordinate a master's in education management and administration. And more recently, and since also my PhD project was about project-based learning, and it was back in 2005 when I started. It was when Bologna Declaration was implemented and the courses changed their approaches, their methodologies, and so focused on seeing how did PBL change the way students learned and how teachers prepared their work. And recently about this, I have been doing my research mostly about active learning in higher education. And at my institution, I coordinate the Pedagogical Innovation Office, which develops activities about teacher training, teacher professional development, active learning, support staff with providing materials, providing help in designing courses, etc. So, and here a little bit about what I do and my research interests and work. This in the middle, a recent publication, an ebook with some of my colleagues from the University of Minho who are here. Also, Annabella Alves, who participates in project-based learning experience in the first year of industrial engineering and management. And what I'm going to share with you today is the result of some papers presented in this conference, which is Project Approaches in Engineering Education, which started with a group of educators and engineers who wanted to dedicate themselves to develop engineering education. So this is a little bit about the background and to understand why am I here and how did I come, why am I studying this. So if we wanted to start with the idea about student engagement and see how can we approach this, how can we get students engaged in learning, and probably since the title of my presentation you can guess that I suggest that PBL and with service learning can do this, but
is the what for. So what's the purpose? What's the purpose of student getting students more engaged in learning? What is this, the purpose of students learning better in a different way? So I think this is one first reflection. I had a mentee teacher, but I think I'm going to skip this part so that I can leave some more time for the rest. It's basically to get you thinking about this so that you can get actively engaged too about the purpose, the what for. And so these two ideas, PBL and service learning, they are both part of this broader approach, which is active learning. And I bring most of you, and because you are here and part of this project in some way, must be familiar, but I'm just going to recall some of our references in this field. Bonnell and Eisen that say that active learning involves students in doing things and thinking about the things that they're doing. Thinking about reflection. The reflection is something that sometimes is a little bit forgotten. So thinking about what they're doing. Feld and Brent, they tell us that active learning is anything course-related, okay, has to be course-related, that all students in the class session are called upon to do other than simply watching, listening, or taking notes. Okay. Some more ideas. The European University Association, in one of their reports on teaching and learning, says that active learning consists of a broad range of pedagogical processes that emphasize the importance of student ownership and activation. So ownership is something that must be part of this process. This is one of the important principles. It also talks about the role of the teachers, which is something that is not new, and from Bologna we know it, that teachers must act as, are seen as facilitators of learning. And when we talk about this, and just to make an overall view, active learning can be done. There are many different ways to approach it, and we have seen some today here, and also with digital tools too, and it can come from, we can classify them in terms of their complexity, which can be organized in more and less complexity approaches, like, for example, using a think-pair-share or a one-minute paper, something that we introduce in class that gets students actively involved, or we can move forward to more complex ways that are more curriculum-based, that imply organizing our learning outcomes, our assessment. We cannot separate learning and assessment, or teaching, learning and assessments. These three must be integrated. And so this is why I'm talking, when I'm bringing you these two approaches to integrate them. Project-based learning first, and then service learning. Service learning, I'll tell you a little bit how I came over it more recently. And so these two approaches, project-based learning, I believe most of you are familiar with the idea. But some of the characteristics that define project-based learning are the idea of providing a solution for a problem or for a situation. It involves initiative by a group of students. It's developed with a team, a group of students. It usually results in an end product, okay, which can be a thesis, a report, a prototype, something like that, but it has an end product. It goes, it is developed in a considerable length of time, so usually a semester, for example, to implement it. And teaching staff are involved in this more of a facilitator role. Project-led education, Peter Powell is one of our references in the engineering education about how to implement PBL. This is one of his important books. And also the same idea, team of students with the delivers a team product, discusses it at the end, okay, and reflects about how, about their project and how they achieved the result. Okay? And just what happens when students engage in the project-based learning? Okay? Just a short resume.
What happens when teachers design projects that empower students with voice and choice? Students embrace the maker mindset. They define themselves as inventors and creators. They learn to take creative risks. Here they experiment and engage in iterative thinking. When this happens, they embrace a growth mindset and grow resilient. They become problem solvers and systems thinkers. They become divergent thinkers, thinking outside the box. They'll use creative constraint to find original uses for materials. Here they discover it's okay to be different. Often students embrace curiosity and wonder. They become explorers, seeking out new information and thinking critically. They grow more empathetic as they design meaningful products that they launch to the world. On an academic level, students are more engaged and the information sticks. There's often an increase in student achievement. Meanwhile, they learn key skills like project management, collaboration, and communication. True, these projects will prepare students for the creative economy, but more importantly, they empower students for a creative life. Here they see that making is magic. We know that there's a time crunch in schools. Materials can be scarce. Sometimes you're stuck with a tight curriculum map. But when you, as a teacher, empower your students with voice and choice, they become the makers who change the world.
So, I brought you this short video because it talks about a lot about students, what happens to students, and what some of the results that I'm going to experience that I've shared with you talks about students. I bring you students' perspective of their learning process, okay, of all their engagement. And so some of these ideas that are here about empowering students and how they feel and their critical thinking and mindset will be seen in some of their voices that I bring you. I don't know what happened. Can you please? I just left the presentation. I don't know. Okay, in 1 minute, you'll see a short video of Robert Pringle, who's one of the references on service learning, and he explains very well what service learning is and how what the difference is when we use a community problem to be solved by our students and we give back the solution to the society. And this is one of the missions of the universities, I believe. Example.
Community service learning is academic work, not volunteering.
Community service learning has a lot of potential to engage students in educationally meaningful community service as part of their coursework.
For example, if students remove trash from the banks of a river, is that good community service learning? Probably not. But if students in an environmental science course remove trash from a river, analyze what they find in the field in the laboratory, share the results with government agency and NGOs to formulate recommendations to reduce pollution and develop policy recommendations, and the students reflect on their experiences to connect their service activity with course content and civic issues, then we have good community service learning.
How do I move forward?
The added value of this PBL is to make a project that can be
not just evaluated and placed in the corner, which is how students mostly see the work that they're doing. So they find it more challenging. So they talk about here what they learned, the competencies that they developed, some of the technical ones, some of the soft skills also. Okay, here's something. They learned about themselves. They learned they faced very lots of challenges. At the beginning, they mentioned that they feel a little bit lost, but that it's part of the process. And also, they talk about resilience and the idea of not giving up and knowing that the problem, the solution is not clear, but in a team, they can overcome the different problems that they face. And also, it was during the pandemic, and so they felt that they had to continuously improve and face and overcome all the problems. So I'm trying to give it more quick. I wanted to present you just this one too. And the idea here, we use portfolios, individual portfolios, to document the learning process. And the portfolio could be used. The idea was they had an end product, also a small report, but they could use the Padlet or use a blog so that they can make their reflections throughout the process. The same here, we had three curricular units, it were 12 students, three teams, and there was a topic here. And just to give you an idea about the assessment and the milestones, usually the project approach is organized like this. We have several presentations, several milestones throughout the project. We have another important moment, which is when the students deliver the project report, and they have the opportunity to get feedback from that report, and then they submit a final report. Okay? This is something that students really value and recognize, the opportunity to learn and to get feedback. And we have several ways of doing that too. And at the end, they also create an individual portfolio, which has been developed throughout the process. Okay, I'm just going to... Just bring you one from the engineering experience, which is here. The students also, we analyze students' blogs, and the content from the blogs is here. It's a different team, engineering students. There's 67, much more, 8 teams. The idea follows much the same. The 14 weeks organized much the same with several milestones. They work in teams. They develop a blog, first year students, first semester also. And I'll use the Padlet here to the information. And just a last quote, which I think presents a lot about what happened here. When we started the project, we had no idea where we were going. It was exciting, it was stressful, it was everything. Every emotion possible, we felt it. From panic to laughter, from anxiety to relief, it was full package. This was a chapter in our lives that none of us will ever forget. Our hearts are nothing but filled with joy and love after this semester of absolute madness. We love it. So there's nothing more to say. So this is a part of their loss and where they show how much this experience impacted on them. I'm sorry, I will have to skip all this, but just to finish, project-based learning and service learning can complement each other, and we can make our projects more impactful. And I'll leave you with this question. How are your projects? Are you implementing projects that serve? Okay. And I'll leave you with this.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So
There are six curricular units, and we have one of the curricular units is integrated project. And this is where the project, the main assessment of the project takes place. And there are, each lecture is involved of each course, and each team also has a tutor, which is not one of the lecturers, is another teacher from the department. And they also have a student tutor, which is a senior student, the third year, who has been through PBL, and who also gives, the role of the tutor is to give support in project management and team motivation and all the technical part. But it's a broad, a very broad team, and it has been developed, well, the book that I showed you is the result of more than our last, more than 15 years of PBL implemented in this program, which is where my PhD started, exactly about the impact of this PBL. And so there is a very solid research team and teaching team. And I think if you ask me one of the secrets for this success of this experience is the team, is the staff team. And that makes a big difference.
Do they get training?
Yes. They started off with training. Peter Powell went to the university in 2005 to Minho and gave started with a training session about PBL.
Inspiring,
very inspiring. And so many teachers use that as a starting point. And then once they started, they never abandoned it. And this PBL, for example, it wasn't part of the curriculum. It was then, like I do it in my course, for example. This is an engineering course, so I teach in Portucalense education. And we don't have PBL as a curricular unit. We do it as part of the assessment. We give a part of our assessment.
So this is one course devoted to PBL.
The engineering one?
Yeah.
The first, there's a curricular unit devoted, and all the rest of the curricular units use the same topic to develop the skills, the knowledge, and the assessment methods and all that are shared.
So the head of the study plan has an important role
everyone
together.
Yes.
To be part of this.
It's a big difference.
Yeah, is there resistance between by the students or just because they have an older student in a more advanced year?
Yes, but I think, well, in the engineering program, students, they understand that this is part of the process. This is how the program is seen, and it works, and I think it's not a big issue. The issue is what they complain sometimes about is about everyone. It's the workload. All the constraints sometimes about time management and all these things that are facing when they are in the first year and all that. For example, education students, they also, I find more resistance there because not everyone works with this approach in the program. And so sometimes they see, okay, here I work so hard, I have so much things, and in another course, it's not the same. And so there are differences. And it's really interesting to see the difference between the field, and I think it's very honored to be part of these two areas. So multidisciplinary teams are really, really important for our growth and professional development. Yes.
Any other questions or comments?
Social organizations.
Because it's real life approaches.
Yes. And students go to the institution and they implement, they must do, it's one of the ideas of service learning, they must do a certain number of hours with the community. They have to hear them, they have to be with them in order to
the invitation to be here, to share my experience in the area. I will talk a little about the gamification and theory of games, because I'm from computer graphics, computer science, and I work in the last 10 years in the development of games, and more interested in the theory of games. Games that are not only for fun, but games that can teach. Yes, that can teach some issues to the players. So, I will do a small introduction to the gamification and my point of view, and talk a little about the quantification is related to the gamification. And then, I present some applications that are mentioned in the morning, useful for the teaching process, or the learning process that the students can use. And then I will present some examples how to design serious games and some examples that we create in the last 10 years. So, everyone knows what is gamification, okay? The gamification is using the techniques from the games in context that are not games necessarily. So, but digital games, we need to understand digital games and why digital games motivate or engage the players. Why the players play several times the same game? Why we try several times to defeat the enemy or something? In the games, we have a loop, and we can do several trials. We can fail, but we can try again, and we can improve our skills, and we can try until we proceed for the next level. In the learning process, normally this is not what we have. 1, 2, 3 options to do the text, the exam, and we can not have several times to do the evaluation. And the games give us this opportunity. We can try more, several times, and each player gain some knowledge about the game with the try and error several times. Okay. So, this possibility, if you can use this loop in the evaluations, I think it's useful for students. For example, in my university, in the University of Portugal, in the medical area, the students have some course that use models, and they have several tries to do the model. If you don't pass, you can try again the model and again until pass this model. It's a small approximation to this loop. Okay, so they need to do all the models, but they have several trials for do that. So the gamification is a way to motivate the students, okay, for do some tasks and involve them in the learning process. The motivation are divided into types: extreme motivation and intrinsic motivation. The more simple is the extreme motivation, where we can give bonus scores, badges to our students. budget, some points, some rankings of the students to motivate them to proceed in the learning process. The content gamification need to create the materials in another way. For example, serious game. We need to redefine the materials to teach the issue we want. Related with the gamification, in fact, we have most times the quantification. If you look, for example, for the social networks and somewhere for the internet, most of the things are related with the quantification. We think that it's gamification, but in fact it's the quantification. We know the number of friends, the number of likes, the number of shares, and the number of votes. In fact, this is the quantification. We have several data and we count this data. The number of links, the number of colleagues, etc. So this is the main strategy of the gamification. We use the quantification of data and use it to present in a simple way and give the opportunity to this way, for example, the likes and the shares is a way of recognizing by the community. Okay? I have more likes, I have more friends, I have more shares of my, so, but in fact, this is only a quantification, a number of leads, a number of tasks that I do. So, most of the time, the gamification is associated with the quantification, okay? It's easy, we can give points for our students, it's easy to do, okay? It's one of the most important techniques that we use. In the games, it's the same, we have points in the game, or points or wins, it's similar. So, in the morning, we see several applications that can be useful for motivate students and be a part involved in the learning process. Play, Moodle, etc. But I'm not talking about these applications. I'm more interested in the serious games or, for example, educational paper room. Okay? I will explain later what it is. Okay? But these applications, the main reason is make the students active part of the learning process. Okay, they can do questions, explore ideas, and in the pandemic online, you can interact with the other colleagues, with the teachers, using these kind of applications. Okay. But these applications, you know, inside the project, you have some examples of that, and I'm focused more in the part of games, okay, and the serious games. So, what is the serious game? Serious game is something that will be a game with a learning part involved in the game, or for example, a simulation with some simulation from the something real could be a serious game. And normally involve this part. So serious game involve two these parts. For me and for my experience, a serious game is mainly a game, okay? And then we need to include some learning content or some simulation from the real world, something like that. Why games in the top for me, because there are several examples, the serious games that was developed in the last years, that in fact the students use only one time or two times, because there is not a game. This is more like a digital exercise book or something like that. Okay, so if you want a serious game, you want that the users, the players, the students, play several times. Each time you learn something more. Okay? If you use the game one time, this is not a useful. They not learn in the process of the try error that I presented in the beginning. We can learn by trying several times. So a serious game must be a game first. This means that must be fun. Okay, we can play the game for fun only, but at the same time we have some learning content or some simulation that we can learn. For example, several games, commercial games, for example, the Sin City, you know, is a commercial game for fun, but they simulate the management of a city. So the students, the players, learn some contents how to involve or to manage the city and the resources and some. Okay? So design a serious game for me is design a fun game first and then include the learning content or the simulation. And I will show some examples that we developed in the last 10 years. Okay? And try to explain how we create a game around each. For example, in this case, we have an image from the clean world. This is a 3D game where the player controls the robot. This is in the image, and the robot needs to go to the world and collect items to recycle vehicles and produce a new energy. Okay, so then you have some in the bottom on the image, you have some puzzles, mini games for recycle, for example, for the colors, which type of the item. This is a plastic, this is wood, or etc. And inside the game. But the main mechanics of the game is to collect items from the world. Okay? You can collect and recycle, but not correctly in the beginning, but we can try, and several times we learn that sometimes some items belong to some categories and recycle and improve their knowledge in the recycle. Okay? This is one example that we started in 2012. Another example that we developed, I have not mentioned yet, but we start a master degree in the University of Portugal in the game design development. This year, University of Aveiro start a new one, a similar master and design of games. Okay. So in this case, we have an example to serious game for teaching some issues related to the cybersecurity. Okay. So the idea was start with a solution where the younger with the mobile phone can buy an item and then the link for buy the item block their device. what happened with their device. In the our environment, we create several rooms, and each one is associated with one issue. For example, in the right bottom, we have the room related to the passwords, how to create a security password. We have other room, for example, to share or to share information in the social networks. Okay, and the player have some examples they need to if share or not share, and if it's wrong, we explain why it is not correct to share this information. For example, we have other room related to the phishing that appear when an email message, and in the bottom we need to identify some signs that this is a phish message and not a correct one. Okay, so we need to proceed for every room and learn some content related with cybersecurity. Okay, here this is the example of the serious game for learning the math operations for the primary school. Okay, for the third and fourth grades, and we can see the example of the. And we have some coins only to buy some skins for the bird. And we have some bubbles with the numbers and operators. And we need to buy these bubbles to catch the bubbles to do the operations. Okay? And we have several levels, in this case, four levels. Okay? So I need to move forward. In this case, this is similar to the Want to Be a Millionaire. Okay, this is, we have a bunch of questions, and for each one we have four possibilities. You can choose, for example, to remove two, and this is specific for the students of medical in the University of Coimbra Interior. We design, create the game based in the XML file where we describe the question and the answers possible, and we have an app, in fact. And more recently, we create, in fact, we are developing this project now, a virtual room for a virtual game for be a therapeutic tool for the obsessive compulsive disorders. Okay, we create a room because normally the people, the young people, have these problems related with tasks at home. Okay, the people that need to organize everything by size, by colors, or the people that need to confirm if everything is closed. And you create an environment home and with a virtual environment and with a head mounted display. The people are inside the room and we try to ritualize these behaviors. Okay. So to finish the virtual escape room, is similar to the escape room that we have in the real life, that normally we have a group of people that go to the place, and there are several challenges to solve to escape the room, okay? They need to collaborate in teams to... here we create a small example in the virtual world. For this we have a virtual room. We can see only the hands, okay? And can interact with the objects. In this case, the television gives some tips for the code. There are some the time, and they have some challenge to do. In this case, this is a code, and okay, I don't have more time, so I skip a little. Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. To conclude, so structural gamification it's easy. Okay. Gamification of content is hard to do. You need to create new material, for example, a serious game, and design of serious games is also harder. Need a team for create these kinds. Okay. Quantification is sometimes a good way to engage and motivate the players or the students, okay? Give them some feedback, some instant feedback they appreciate not, okay? Thank you for your attention, okay?
Thank you. Very interesting. Although okay. I understand that it requires some technicalities which people from the social sciences,
yes.
But they need to collaborate with engineers, which is so. Questions or comments?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we talked about the quantification,
yes.
And then you have to process real-time data to give the instant feedback to the student. Which technology? To process all the data and give this feedback, and do you give it in? If I understood it right, you give the feedback within the game.
Yes, inside the game, we give the feedback immediately in the game. Yes, if you choose an option that is not the correct one, we give some information, explain why this is not the correct option. Okay. Inside the game. But for example, inside the other applications, for example, in the Moodle, you can have several tests, you can be evaluated automatically and give the instant feedback for the students too. Okay.
How possible is it to use games, serious games you have developed, or anyone at any university, to different courses? How generalizable is it?
Depend of the issue.
Okay.
You can. For example, for the example, the cybersecurity, okay, you can use the game for different people know a little more about the cybersecurity. It's easy
okay.
to do, depend on the issue, okay?
About the escape room, the education
yes.
escape room, since you had not much time,
can yes.
you talk a little bit more about it? Do you use it for a specific part of the content to explore that content?
Yes.
How is it used?
In this case, it's only a small example. But for example, for nurses training, for medical training, you can have a room, a physical room, where you have some patients and some exercise that they need to solve for this case. And this, in our case, we try to move this for the virtual world, okay? And for example, apply it for cybersecurity or for programming. Or this is our background, okay?
Feedback from students, is it positive?
Yes,
like it?
Yes, because in fact they need to work with teams and collaborate with each other, and it's like the project-based learning that we use in the master's degree in some courses too.
Okay.
Okay.
Very nice. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Marisa, and I'm here with my colleague Rosário from Catholic University. And we are here to talk a little bit about our experience with this approach, problem-based learning. So I will start to talk a little bit of how we came to this approach, and then my colleague will share our experience in psychology. First of all, we would like to thank the invitation and the organization of this event. It is being inspiring to be here with you today. So, we came talk a little bit about the moment when we decided to use problem-based learning. As is mentioned in the title of this presentation, we teach in psychology in the first year of the graduation, and when we started this methodology, we were wondering about how to help our students to develop some skills that they needed to address challenges from a society that is changing. Society is changing a lot, both in multiple dimensions, technological, political, social, and so on. And we were worried about the skills our students at the first year had, and how we can improve our teaching practice to address and to improve their non-cognitive skills. Of course, we also wanted that they have the specific knowledge that they have to have in our curricular unit, but we also wanted to prepare our students to be future psychologists in this challenging society. So change for us was not an option, it was needed and also an obligation. So we were inspired by some ideas related to pedagogical innovation, and here are some ideas that we consider when we explored pedagogical innovation. So to sum up, we were worried, or we wanted to give the students a more active role in the process of learning, and that make us change our work in the classroom. We needed to change aspects like the assignments, like the spaces, like the times, and also the way as we work as a teachers. We also have to improve our use of specific tools, and also in the way we assess our students and the skills they had to develop in the context of the curricular units that we have. So we have also explored some innovative pedagogical practices, and we decided to use problem-based learning because we thought at that moment that it will best suit to our aims in this curricular unit that Rosario then will talk a little bit. But why and how? Briefly, why? We wanted to, first of all, to help our students to develop these types of skills. The specific knowledge, of course, related to the topic that we teach, but also how to solve problems, how to make decisions, how to communicate, how to collaborate, how to work in teams, how to think and reflect. So we decided to use this approach, and by definition, this approach is a way where students work together to solve authentic and ill-structured complex problems related to real life, and they must work in a collaborative way with support with the teachers. So that's the way that we work with our students. And now Rosário will talk a little bit about our experience.
Mm-hmm. So as Marisa was saying, we made this sort of trajectory of change that I will show you a bit more now. Our module is in the second semester of the first year of the Bachelor in Psychology, and we work with them on three major topics: learning, memory, and motivation. So it's a big module. It's just the two of us. We've been having, since 2017, we've been having classes that range from 60-something students to 80-something students. So it's been challenging over the years to adapt problem-based learning with our with just the two of us for these large classes. But as I was saying, this was really, we didn't just change like that. We went step by step. So first we were quite traditional. We had the lectures, we had more practical classes, but more with the activities that they would work on, very loose, nothing very well together organized, nothing curriculum based. Then we tried to move forward in 2018 to a more semi-traditional, we call it like that. So when we started to, we did, it wasn't really a project-based learning, but we proposed a more long-term throughout the semester activity or project that they would that they did completely autonomously. We almost didn't guide them through it. And then they presented to us in the end, and we had really good surprise for us. And that gave us like the push to, okay, next year, let's do it. Let's try to change. And we also tried to change already in this year a bit the assessment process to see how we could adapt it in the next year. So 2019 was the year we chose to do the pilot experience, which was great because it was mixed with the COVID-19 at the same time. And we started very, the way that we thought, we didn't know anything about problem-based learning, so we studied about it. We learned about it mostly from one book that was a bit our Bible throughout the process. And so we started with some brief expositions of the learning content in specific moments throughout the semester. And then we also changed the assessment process, having self and hetero assessment. And as well, we increased a lot the amount of feedback we were giving throughout the time, the monitoring process. We used three problems, as I will explain later, and we tried as well, like the colleague from before was explaining, the loop of the trial, error, feedback, and so everything the students did, we provided feedback and we allowed them to improve. In the year after, so since then, we've been using the problem-based learning, something that has changed, of course, because of COVID, we've had to change to fully online in 2020. This year was blended, some part of the course was online, some part was face-to-face. And we also, one of the improvements we made was we included assessment rubrics, So we didn't have a lot of guidance for the students in terms of what they were doing and what we were actually assessing in all the tasks. And we included this, so I'll show you some examples in a bit. And another thing we did is that we included also in the course for the memory topic, collaborative online international learning. So we've been working with a university from Brazil, and this part of this topic is a bit different because it's only through this collaborative online international learning. Then another change we've made, that we felt relevant, we felt a lot of resistance from students related to this new learning environment. We are the only one, at least so far, we are the only ones in the first year doing this sort of pedagogical innovation practice. And we feel a lot of resistance from students at the beginning, not from all, but from some. And so we found that it was better, and this is also proposed in the literature, to spend a bit more time in the initial classes, in the first weeks, just to let students be more aware of what it is, how it's going to work, and also in the team building activities development, so that each group actually knows each other before they continue the work after. So this is some changes we've made. I'm gonna talk to you more about the pilot experience. So what we did is that we try, of course, there are several ways to do PBL. We tried to design it in a way that we thought made sense for us, in a way that it would be, so PBL was our primary instructional approach. But it was a hybrid approach because we also combine it with other approaches such as direct instruction or flip learning, inverted classroom. We also combine some moments of this with the PBL approach. So this is the book that I was saying that it was a bit our Bible, The Power of Problem-Based Learning, a practical how-to for teaching undergraduate courses in any discipline. And we've been using several activities proposed in these books, not just for the team building part, but as well throughout the activities, how to give feedback to students within this approach, how to assess what we are doing, if students are actually learning or not, etc. As I was saying, it's an individualized degree of integration in the organization, so it's not like some bachelors that are all problem-based learning. This is not the case, and it's the two of us. So what we decided to do is, and we decided that it would be better to do three problems. So we thought it would suit better. The topics are very different. The content, although it is interconnected, is different. And so we decided to do one problem for learning, just to learn and to study learning topic, one for memory and one for motivation, which of course increases a lot the workload for us as well. In terms of, it's not the numbers of problems, sorry, in the second one, it is all the skills that we are aiming most of all to promote in the students, and this is what we share with them. So we want really to improve the interpersonal relationship, the conflict management, which is always, always present every year. The problem solving, of course, not just the social problem solving, but as well the how to apply content that you learn to a proper problem. Learning self-regulation, because students are extremely autonomous. They have a lot of challenge with this. They have to be able to keep up with the timelines on their own, do their own things, study and research as much as they want to. So we give a basic of what we want them to research and to read, but it's dependent on the students if they want to go further and how much they want to go further. And of course, the research, oral and writing communication, there's a lot of presentations throughout the process. And a lot of reports, and as well research skills, especially the search part and how to filter what is relevant and good quality and what it's not, especially in the field of psychology, it's very important. Of course, the assessment, we tried multiple forms of assessment, both individual and group assessment, which includes oral presentations. We ask weekly reports to students, as well final reports for each problem. And we also have a grid for self and peer assessment related to the problem-based process and how it worked between them, that they fill up at the end of each problem, so they have a possibility to speak to each other about it. And brief writing work, which is individual assessment. So basically, I'm going to show you what for us are our checklists so far. It's going to be fast. So our checklists, basically, it's what from all these different years, it has not been a long time, but from these different years of implementation, what we feel works the best and that we intend to maintain throughout the time. First is the creation of groups and working teams. With this part, we are not entirely sure if how to do it, because so far we've been letting students choose the groups themselves. There are some people that suggest, some researchers that suggest that we can allocate students to those groups, but For now, it has been working like that, and it's been seems to be better like that, especially in a first year. We also attribute roles, or we give ideas of roles that students can have within their groups, such as leader of discussion, timekeeper, the register, and we teach them about these different roles. And we incentivize students to rotate these roles, if not during the problem, at least at the end of each problem, so from one problem to another, so that they can, of course, learn different skills. So this is one of the activities we do first with them, where we put them talking to each other, because although it's the second semester, many times they don't know each other. So it's really to put them talking to each other. Who are we? Who do we, you know, what do we want to call our group? What is the team of our group? What are the functioning rules that we want to keep up in this group? Is it never to be late? Is it to always let us know if you're not going to be part of a class? Whatever, they can define here the rules, but as well we ask them what are their strengths individually and as well their weaknesses when it comes to working in a group. We also want to keep the one problem per topic, and this is one of the biggest challenges with problem-based learning, which is to design the problem. It needs to be ill-structured. And we try to for it to be as relatable to them as possible. So it's been usually around higher education students or psychology. And we try to keep it really real and up to date. And so far we have not done one problem the same in any year. So that of course is challenging for us. And just one problem, because there are other perspectives of problem-based that you can give several different problems to the same class. We don't think that would work for us. So these are some examples of the problems we've been having, how to motivate university students to do more physical exercise. This was a news just the day before we gave these problems to them. Of course, learning in times of COVID, how can we improve distance learning in psychology? The climate crisis, which has been very talked about within psychology, how can they motivate university students for change? And as well, we proposed to them our own problems. How can we be better teachers to you? How can we help you be better psychologists in the future. So these are just some products that they have done, some examples. They've created websites, they've created apps, they have created blogs for the sports part. They have created a blog to help university students self-regulating with their own stories, and it's very nice. And they also created, for instance, a cube with different innovative pedagogical activities for teachers to do within the class. Another element that's very important we find is the structure that we provide to the problem-based learning process. Our students, they need a lot of structure. Maybe it's because they are first year, but they need a lot of structure. Otherwise, they ask too many questions several times. So we try to do that. And the support. So the support we give them throughout the semester is extremely important. They need it to provide monitoring, but as well to provide feedback, because one of the things they tell us is, well, but we don't know if we're doing a good work or not until the end of the problem. And so we try to improve this part, and we give them more feedback throughout the time. So this is some examples we've done. We've done like tips on how they can start their work in each class to help them start to work. We give them also, we ask for the weekly report, and we give them feedback about this weekly report, if they are meeting the marks or not, if they are going too far, just stop reading and work, these type of things. And as well, clear rules and instructions. So we've done, this year we started a support guide to help them at the beginning of the year know exactly how is problem-based learning environment and everything that's going to happen. We give them so we specify on a report, for instance, what they need to show us that they have learned, so that we can assess it. We've done Q&A as well, for especially in the first year. We give the class calendar so they know exactly what's going to happen. And then of course we do formative assessment, like I've been explaining, and a lot of monitoring, which is a big challenge to us. So I'm not gonna do this part. The students like a lot, just like Sandra, I think, mentioned, one of the things they struggle the most is the workload, which is funny, and the time management, especially because of the availability between all the members of the group, which is comprehensible because in our university we have many students from different ages working at the same time, so this is understandable. For us, we also have challenges doing this. We continue to have challenges. Time is the most important one, is to have time to, because it's time, more workload for the students, but it's more workload for us for sure as well. So pedagogical innovation is good. We do think it's a facilitator for learning, but it's difficult for us, especially at the beginning, I think. I think more and more we are more at ease, but the assessment part takes a big toll on us, because it has to be, you know, it's different doing an exam than doing several tasks throughout the year. And that's it.
Thank you.
I think I really enjoyed it as well as the previous ones, and I think one important message is you don't have to be an expert. Need to want to change something in our lectures, and I think it's important that message is important, because sometimes we hear some talks and we're like, oh, I couldn't do this as an expert or so. It doesn't have to be, we just need to have some support, peer support. And I was going to mention that we launched a collaborative platform, so online, so that the teachers can exchange resources as the one you showed. I can give you Natalia and the link so that you can go there if you like. Yes, questions you have? Okay, I was going to next one. So Margarida did a training in Maastricht on PBL, problem-based learning. So you might want to talk to her in the end.
Because you were just saying that you let students choose the group, but it's, as it is the first year students, they don't know each other very well, so it's very easy for you to make the groups based on a criteria that you decide. I don't know if it is first semester or second. Okay, so you can, for instance, base your criteria on the grades they had previous semester and the grades they had when they entered the university, and so you can arrange a group with good students, better students, and not so better students. But in this problem-based learning, sometimes the grades doesn't mean that they know how to work better in group, and so it's very interesting to see this this type of connection. And also, we have agreed to assess their performance in the group. So I don't know if you have each group with a teacher or a facilitator, or if you have all the groups working together.
We have all the groups working together.
Okay, so this is much complicated because we have one facilitator per group.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's also why we don't, I forgot to say that, but we have chosen to put a maximum of 6 students per group, and we are thinking of making it even smaller than that, maybe 5, because without that facilitator that I know it's present in other PBL, it's difficult for the group to be able to organize themselves, maybe in another
there are some
year.
Universities that use facilitators like researchers or older students, and sometimes it works very well.
Yes.
Yes, great. Thank you for the suggestion.
I really enjoyed this presentation, and I'm happy that you tried to do it just based on your Bible. So that's really nice.
We don't even know if it's the best book.
We just found it.
It's the best book
and
for you guys.
We just started.
So, and I'm wondering, it's a bit provocative what I'm going to say, but have you thought about including another course unit also? I'm saying that you are both lecturing this course and you think that you are too little, and how about broadening? Because when you talk about three, you have three challenges, right? One for each. And I'm wondering, I think that probably each one of these could be even a curricular unit, because you're doing it seems very deep, maybe you're going really deep in the, and I don't know if students are getting the bigger approach. Have you ever thought of maybe including other courses? Because probably students, at the end, they're not just going to solve problems based on this specific field of knowledge. They have to have the bigger picture. And this is one of the advantages I think PBL brings. They have to look at, go get this from here, get this from there, and they're not so narrowed in the content that is needed for this and to be assessed and all that. It's just an idea that can make you go one step further, maybe. So you have to convince your colleagues.
Yes. Yes. Sometimes we invite some teachers from other areas or domains to work with us and to give some lectures, and also to discuss with the specific group specific things and yes related to the problem that we presented. Yes, mm-hmm. Sometimes we can work like that, but we try.
Yeah.
Step by step.
Yeah. Then we have a peer observation program, so teachers from different scientific fields go and go to a lecture, so maybe you can try that.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. To stimulate.
Yes.
The colleagues. So thanks a lot again.
Thank you.
So now we go to Minho. Or Minho comes to us. José Alberto Lencastre will try to ask the question of whether we digital technologies to innovate.
start?
Yep.
The floor is yours.
Good afternoon. First of all, I want to thank you to Professor Natalia and also our colleagues like Paulo and Julia for inviting me to be here in this multiplier event, and also congrats on the project and of the all the products that were produced during the process, and then congrats to all the partnership of the Erasmus project. I am José Alberto, I am from the University of Minho, the Institute of Education, and I'm a member of the the Department of Curricular Studies and Educational Technology, and my expertise is on educational technology. My main research interests are related to innovative pedagogical practices with a focus on blended learning models, active methodologies, and also digital technologies. Okay, this is my website, and my presentation is about pedagogical innovation and digital technologies. And if some of you know me from previous presentations, I prefer to use images. More image and then words, and I need to involve the audience with my lectures and with my presentation, so I would love to have you involved in this. And the first task I will ask you is to go to that website using your mobile devices and try to say to what is your position. This, do you think that pedagogical innovation needs digital technologies? When we talk today about pedagogical innovation, it's something that is related to the use of digital technologies. Do you think that is fundamental, or you think it's an option? So this is the address, poolav.com/jlencastre. Okay. So for the majority of the public in audience, innovative pedagogical practice.
practices are related to digital technologies. So today we talk about innovation in our pedagogical approaches. We talk also about using digital technologies, but some of you think that it's not. It could be using digital technologies or not. Okay. This image is an image that maybe it's the most used pedagogical approach of in our universities. Someone talking to an audience that is listening. Sometimes we say that this is a very it's an approach with a focus on the teacher and not on the students, and not on the students as active learners. But during the last 50, 60 years, maybe this is the most used pedagogical approach in universities. But then we had the COVID, and the COVID changed everything. For me, it is the turning point that that changed the way we approach our education, our classes, our pedagogical approaches, our subjects, the way we make our lectures. Some of maybe it's not the audience here, maybe because you are all interested in new pedagogical approaches, but there's a lot of colleagues that even want to erase these past 2 years and get back to the previous way, to the previous way of giving lectures. Why do I think that is the turning point? Because even that the colleagues that didn't like, whatever, the digital technologies they use for their personal life, their personal purpose, but they think that it's not the case of using in their classes. Even that colleagues need to use some technology in the past 2 years due to the pandemic. So they need to start using technology, using video conferencing to engage with the students, to be in contact with the students. And it is not something that was organized, prepared. An idea of some maybe someone that decided that okay, from now on we are going to work online, but it's an emergency. So it is an emergency. We didn't have distance education, because distance education is another thing. It's something that needs to be prepared. We have emergency remote learning or emergency remote teaching. We prepared ourselves the way we could. The universities and the schools help organizing some courses, activities, helping the teachers to work at the distance, helping the students. But we have a lot of problems because we are not prepared. No one were prepared to work online, because to teach online at a distance, we need to know how to do it, and we need to use different pedagogical models to work online. Sometimes the best way was to use our mobile phones, our mobile technologies. So we use different ways to approach our students and to make the learning possible. couple of months ago, I was in a project, and someone told me, thanks God, the online stopped, and we don't need online anymore because we are here face to face. And I was mad with him because the technology and the online technology was the way to keep the students learning and the teachers teaching. If we don't have any online technology, it will be even worse. So of course, we like to be with each other. We like to be face to face. I work in the university that is face to face teaching and learning. So all our classes are face to face. But with that, the knowledge that we had during the COVID, although we are in the end, because we are not prepared, because it was an emergency, because we were away of our comfort zone, because all our resources were not adapted to work online, because our students were not prepared to work online, because we hadn't the technology that is the best one. We didn't know how to use some pedagogical models to work online, so everything was different. In the end, we were maybe like this man, exhausted, but we learned a lot in a very short period of time. So that's why I think that we were in the best moment to make this shift from a traditional model where the classes are with a focus on the teacher to change to a new paradigm that is with a focus on the students. So in the University of Minho, I belong to a group. I'm a member of a group of teaching innovation that is coordinated by the Pro-Rector, Professor Manuel João, and is dedicated to teaching innovation and to helping the teachers and the students to work in different pedagogical models. So it's an innovation and development of teaching and learning group. It's idea. We have a lot of moments during our year and our school year that we are also involved with the University of Aveiro and with the Vice-Rector, Professor Sandra. So this is an image of one of our sessions in this group. So we work with the teachers. We try to involve the teachers using digital technologies, learning how to approach the students in using online. We used the face-to-face moments during these past 2 years to put the teachers working together and trying to share some pedagogical models, new pedagogical models, to work face-to-face, but also to work online and to use digital technologies in the classes, even if the classes are face-to-face. So this is some image, an image for the students as well. So in our training in this with this group, it's a group with teachers from different schools in the university. We have this approach that is based on the pedagogy, new pedagogical models to teach and learn, with technology, mostly using digital technologies, and space, the new learning space. Spaces could be face-to-face, but not only use, for instance, the way that is organized this session, with everybody looking at me and
side by side and in lines, but also working in pairs, working in groups. But also these learning spaces are the new learning spaces that we use during COVID with the platforms that provide us a place or a space to engage with the students, to be linked with the students, to place our resources, to make the assessment, all the work that we did during these past 2 years. The pedagogical models that we used during this COVID, we used a lot of these training reports from the Open University in the UK, that is with us cases with different pedagogical approaches. Some of them are very well known. This is free. This is in that blog that is provided here. But some of these pedagogical approaches are in this book that was presented in the University of Minho. Professor Mike Chappell was also here in the University of Aveiro a couple of years ago before COVID. And this book present 40 new ways to teach and learn. Some of them that pedagogical approaches we know very well, flipped learning, for instance, gamification. We have a colleague talking about gamification, also the project talked about gamification and also game-based learning, very well-known digital storytelling, cooperative learning and collaborative learning. We have already 4 minutes. Okay, let's go to develop a task. Okay, what is something that is, although all that pedagogical approaches are very different, maybe some of you know 3, 4, 5, some of you use 3 or 4 or 5 of these pedagogical approaches, but in the end, if you know a lot of different approaches, it's better. And that's what we intend to do in our training. All of these approaches have the same basic idea. It's don't teach what the student can learn for himself. So that approach that is focused on the teacher is not a very good way to put this into practice. So if you can give the resources or give the training or provide all the info that your students need to learn for themselves, it's not learning alone, it could be learning with their colleagues, it is better than waiting for the teachers to explain. And students learn best when they are in control of their learning. This is very important because it's providing the students the meaning of that content, of the subject. What is the place of the subject in the course? Why are they learning this? Why this task? Why this activity? What is the relation between the different activities in different weeks, what is the relation of all these activities? So the student must be in control to let the teachers, the teacher, not be the focus of the process. From all that pedagogical approaches, one of that Professor Natalia asked me to talk about, it was explore first. And the meaning of this approach is one of the approaches that are in this book from Mike Chappell's is you don't need to teach the students. We need to design a task for him to do, working alone, at home, using online, resources or working in the class with their colleagues. So if this is something that you could use alone or you could use in groups. For me, for instance, I prefer to use in groups in the class because the students are all in the class and everything that needs to be working alone, they could do that it's at home. So, do I have time to small?
How much?
It depends on them.
So, 5 minutes.
Okay, 5 minutes. So, you only have 5 minutes. Let's try to put into practice this approach. The main idea of this approach is the first time that the students learn about the topic or the content is doing a task. So what could be this task? I will put here a video, small one, 1 minute only. Sorry, because
to apply it in your photography, you need to divide the entire frame using two horizontal and two vertical lines, creating 9 blocks in the frame. Where those two vertical and horizontal lines intersect, we'll have 4 intersecting points. According to the rule of thirds, if you place your main subject on those points, the whole composition would look more interesting and lively. As most of the cameras have an inbuilt rule of thirds guide, you can easily use this feature to apply the rule of thirds in your composition.
Okay, rule of thirds. You have in your mobile phones this grid for the rule of thirds. Everyone has it on your mobile phones. So try to see in the camera of your iPhone if you have the grid of the rule of thirds. Anyone need help? No? Rule of thirds, no?
A very important thing that when you use these devices is to know how to use it, yes. Settings for iPhone, settings, camera.
Camera,
and grid.
Grid, yeah, okay, so.
So some of, in all these devices, all the cameras, but also in the smartphones, we have the rule of thirds. So the rule of thirds, it's two horizontal lines and two vertical lines that divided the frame into 9 equal rectangles.
The rule of thirds is heavily used by all types of photographers as it is a proven rule for producing eye-catching. But the question is, how does it work? Well, when you place your subject in the middle of the frame, it signifies as a static object to your brain, and the viewer's eyes are forced to keep the concentration on the center part. After observing the center position, the eyes are left without a clue about where to look next as the distance from the subject from both the left and right part is the same. This leads to confusion and the viewer loses interest in the image very soon. On the other hand, if the subject is placed on the intersecting point of the rule of thirds, there is more space in either of the edges. So after observing the subject, the viewer's eyes are automatically drawn to the larger portion of the edge. This leads the viewer to find more things in the frame and thus spending more time observing your image. This is why you should use the rule of thirds in most of your compositions.
Okay, if you understood what is the rule of thirds, share it with your colleague. Now, okay, try to see if you understand the same thing regarding
regarding the use of the low flows.
Your colleague, and make a photo from your colleague using the rule of thirds. Okay, and after making the photo, upload the photo to
the my platform that is using a QR code.
After doing the photo, please upload to the platform using this QR code. Images, maybe this could be a different approach. Giving the student the info that he needs to approach the subject, the content of the topic. The student explore. Maybe it could be sharing what he has already understood about the content with the colleagues. Maybe we could make working in groups. And then, using the content that the students upload to the platform, we could start our lecture and interacting with the student. Maybe we could ask, for instance, this student, how do you use the rule of thirds? What is for you the rule of thirds? What is the difference between this image and this image? So you can use the content that the students provide to engage them and to involve them in the class. So this is one of the 40 new pedagogical approaches that are in this book from Mike Sharples and also in the report from the Open University that we could use with our students to try to involve them in classes and have different pedagogical approaches in our classes and not using only the same traditional approach. So thanks.
Thank you, José. We're running out of time. Just like to ask whether you think digital technologies are fundamental or just an option?
For me?
Yeah.
Digital technologies are nowadays the same of pedagogical innovation. If you don't use you have already.
It's not showing.
This it's not consensual, of course, but.
No.
Oh.
You
oh, not today.
Yeah.
But you saw that that image with the. With this triangle, and that's why this is with the same size of each dimension. For me, the pedagogical dimension, the technology, and the learning space, it's a three dimension that needs to be together to have pedagogical, innovative pedagogical approach.
Okay, thank you. You can ask questions afterwards if you'd like to. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we go to our final speaker, Margarida Fardilha, PBL Masters from the University of Aveiro. And Margarida will talk about how can we improve the learning environment and students' motivation through combination of space learning and team-based learning. And she will talk about the differences between online and face-to-face perspectives. And I was just remembering that when we launched our professional development program for professors at the University of Aveiro, that's when we invited Mike Sharples. It was in that inaugural session. And Margarida asked for the book. And I think what she's presenting comes derived from part
of it. Yeah.
So Mike Sharples again.
Okay, so I am from the University of Aveiro, and this is, I'm going to present some work that is not only done by me, but by other colleagues and also students. And so the first time I saw this seminar, and I was really happy because it gave me like the, I was thinking about doing something like that before, but I was not sure if I could. But then it came and it told us that this is really scientifically approved. So this gave me the what I needed to start. And so what I'm going to present you today, it's about this, improving learning environment and students' motivation through a combination of two methods that are spaced learning and team-based learning. So team-based learning is more, I think, more known. And spaced learning is the out-of-the-box thing, I think. So this is, just to give you a context, this is done in the biomedical sciences degree. First year student, second semester. And this is a three-hour class, theoretical class. But of course, we could discuss why we have theoretical classes, practical classes, and all this kind of stuff, and why can't we mix everything together. And then I thought that I should go and ask for the help of other colleagues because I'm not from the educational field. And so I asked the help of a colleague from the education, the help of a colleague from informatics, and also from the sports. I'm a biochemist. So this was really important for the project development. And so the goals of this project at the beginning were to implement these strategies, the two together, because I'm there was no there were no publications about these two mixed together, and so I was thinking that I should do this for many reasons. A reason was that I had a three-hour class, so I should engage students during 3 hours. And then I was the only teacher in the class for almost 100 students. And so I had to invent something that I could manage. And then, like, colleagues developed some collaborative and practices with colleagues with different competencies. And then include students also as partners of this project, because they are really important in all of this and for the things to have success. And also the other part that I was not very sure at that time is how can I at the end publish these results, because I think they are really important. And so I have to think about this from the beginning, and this was with the help of a colleague from the education field. And so we have many data that we have gathered during this time, and also share the results of this with others, and let others, colleagues that want to come to my class and assist and make questions. And so I always have other colleagues in my classes, many colleagues. Sometimes are too much. So just to introduce, for the ones that don't know, spaced learning allows you to quickly apprehend information in long-term memory. And usually, this is applied for younger students. And usually what they do is this organization, three moments of intense input of information, that is called the stimulus. And then they are separated by intervals where they do other activities that have nothing to do with the classes. So they can do physical activity or manual activities. And so this was really interesting, because it made me start thinking what I was going to do with them during the intervals. And if they were going to be happy with it, or, you know, first year university students, but it was really interesting. And then the team-based learning that is very used in the Minho for the medicine students, I think. So it's like PBL, problem-based learning, but different in that a single teacher can manage many students, and they are still working in groups, but all in the same class. So the first thing is they have to study before they come to class, and this is really also difficult to motivate them to study before coming to class. And then when they arrive to the class, into the class, they have to do a questionnaire individually, and then the same questionnaire with the group. The group is always the same during the semester. And then we do also an application activities for them to see if they could understand the contents they have studied by themselves. And so this is like the organization of our class, but I have, so they come to the class. I allow them 15 minutes because it's a big amphitheater and that they have to, you know, talk a little bit with each other. This is at the Friday morning. So here in Aveiro, they go out on the day before, on the night before. And so, you know, I ask always them to come to class, even if they are sleeping, but they have to come. And they have a way of doing that. So music at the entrance. And so they start and they come and they are really happy with it. And I try to fill them. Usually the classes are at 9 and I come at 8 to university to prepare the room. I'm crazy. And then they do this individual test or questionnaire. And I always use, like Luis said, they can use always their mobile phones, because if you prohibit that, they will use it anyway for their personal things. So it's better if they use it for class. So we have QR codes for the questionnaires. And so they do it by themselves to see if they have studied enough. And then the same questionnaire with the group, so they can improve, they can talk with each other and see how they have answered the previous questionnaire. And then I present the results of the questionnaires to the class, and they can ask everything they want about the content, so they can be, they, all doubts are clarified at this moment. So it's a little bit different from PBL, where the facilitator is not usually allowed to explain anything in the class. And then we have the first break where they go and have coffee and go to the bathroom and whatever. And the timings are always very well. We always do it very sharply because it's very difficult to coordinate all of this by myself. And then they come, we do the application exercise that is with very strict rules. They can follow the rules, so it's quite easy to do it. And easy to do it, not the content, but the way we do it. And then we have a second break. And this break is always really nice because I have a colleague from the sports area that comes to the class at around 11 o'clock. And when they know her and they see her coming, it's really interesting to see how they change their faces for happy faces. And it's always different, the intervals, and it's always, they don't know what they are going to do, so they ask for things, they ask for some dancing, some music, whatever, usually, but then we decided. And this is nice because we take 8 to 10 minutes doing the activity and the extra minutes are for preparing it, and I will give you an example after. And then at the end, they stop, they sit, it's really interesting to see how they change, and we start reviewing. I start asking what they have more to ask about the content, and so I explain. Usually I can put here the PowerPoint of the content that they have studied at home, and I go through the slides, but in a quick mode, you know, and I only stop in the slides they want to ask something. And then I give them the content for the next class. The content I always put, I think I have here. So this is just an example. This is an individual questionnaire. This is a group questionnaire. This was the correct answer. And when they go alone, they fail much more. When they go in group, and then I can see how many students, how many groups have failed, and I can explain why this is not the question that they choose. Or I can ask other students to explain to this, and they don't, I know which group is, but I don't tell them which group is, so they don't need to say, oh, I was wrong, okay? So this is the application. We have a Padlet, and this I put the exercise there in the class, and with all the instructions, so they have to answer a question, but sometimes they have to answer it by doing just writing in the Padlet or just by doing a Word or a PowerPoint or whatever. And they have to insert it in the Padlet, and then I can go there and check for every answer and give my feedback. And I do it every week for all the groups. And so for instance, in this case, I write always here a note on the exercise, usually a positive thing, and then the negative stuff. And I always put the correction of the exercise so they can, if they want to see it. About the breaks, that are the most interesting parts of my class, although they are not biochemistry at all. So the purpose of this was to allow a cognitive break in a dynamic way so that students can return to the learning process. So usually my colleagues from my department, they ask me always, how can you just teach for 3 hours, a theoretical class? And I said, I don't, of course. It was to be crazy, just for me, and especially for the students. And so we do this. And so one member of our core team tries to organize. We organize it at the beginning, which kind of activities we will do, but we can change it, of course. And then the duration. It is not mandatory, so if they don't want, they can leave or sit. This almost never happens, almost. And every day this is different and a surprise. And the thing that is interesting is that when I decided to do this, we went online. And so I was really anxious to do this online. But it works very well because they can do the physical activities. Imagine, I don't know if you had any exercise when we were online, when we were at home, but many people did exercise with a teacher, you know, on the camera, and this is quite the same. And they always have almost always have the camera on without me asking. And so maybe this is a video that shows you slightly quickly examples. So my colleague, informatic colleague, helped me to do this, of course. The space is very limited. I would like to have a big room for them. It's really nice. So this guy here was always at the bottom of the class, and then when we started, it just ran for the front, for example. And I always do this, so of course, myself, because it's an example. Okay. So, in terms of strategies to engage the students, and what we got from this project, we have a web page, we have a Padlet that concentrates all the information. We have a forum in Padlet where I tell them that I will answer always in 24 hours. And so also they can answer to each other's doubts. And I always go there to see to check if they are okay. Bibliography I give them weekly, because I don't know if anyone of you had biochemistry at university. Is big book, and so I try to divide this in pieces. And also with audio lessons, all the PDFs that I give them, I did audios. I never listen to my audios, so because if I do, I will have to repeat. So weekly quizzes and application exercises with the responses after the school, after class. Results of every assessment, I will tell you then how I assess, are also given on time and every week, and they never do something that is to assess before they had the previous assessment. They also have a class that is volunteer for doubts, for the ones that want, and usually at 7 or 8 o'clock at night, online. So, because I felt that some of them would need more support than others, and so this was the way I did it. And sometimes they ask me at which time can we have a class, and I said every time, because I don't have any other things to do in my life, so you can choose. And so this, but it's nice to do that. Awards to the groups that are the best groups in doing something, for instance, to the best dancers, like awards like a chocolate or something. It's not. They also have to do a project, and I try always the project to be important for them. For instance, we go to meetings. I register them in meetings by talking to the organizations, and they go and present posters for the first time in their lives, or other things. We also have a radio where they put the music they like. And sometimes there are music that I hate and I can support, so I just skip. And usually I can see which student has put there that music, because he starts looking, and I say, no, now I cannot have this music. And then we have also done this year a flash mob, because I thought I had to do something special for them this year to celebrate how the semester went. And so this is lots of work, extra class for me, and also for them. In terms of assessment, that is the first thing I usually think about, and I usually think about this with the students, so they can see if they can tell me if they agree or not, what they would like to change. Of course, if I don't agree with them, I always try to convince them that this is the best way, but usually we agree. And they have really nice opinions about this. And it's very nice to hear how they think about their assessment. So two normal tests. Attendance, this is very important, and people usually don't do this. I give them, so if they come to class, they will have 1 in 20 without doing anything except coming to class. And the table that we made with the students they did it. And they said for if we have 14 classes, they will have the top 20. But if they come only to 10, they will have the 10. And then in the middle, they did it by themselves, what they thought was the best way. And most of them, they have 19 or 20. So they always come. Of course, except if they have, they have a disease or whatever, of course, it will not count. Then they also have peer, this is individual assessment, and the peer assessment in within the group with a very organized table and very objective table of criteria that I try, that I tell them how, what I expect them to do. And for the TBL, for the questionnaires, and for the exercise of application, they have usually 12 during the semester. And for from the 12, for each group, I choose three to assess. And they don't know which day they are going to be assessed. So in the beginning of the class, when I put the questionnaire, I put the numbers of the groups I will assess. And so they have to come to have the assessment and a project. It depends. I always change the project. I try that they do everything in group, like Luis said, in class. The individual study or other things that are individual, maybe out of class. Okay, we did the... So this is about the project itself and not about the classes, but initially we have focus groups with students and also with teachers. And at the middle of the semester, we also have focus groups. My diary, I always write everything, what I do and what I should do better. And also observation by other colleagues. And at the end, also a focus interview. A focus group interview and also questionnaires. One questionnaire that I give them that is more specific for the course, and the other questionnaire is from the university, so a general questionnaire. I'm finishing. And so this is students' feedback. We have many, lots of data that we are just preparing to publish. I put here just what I thought, just good things. So this is our questionnaire that is in the scale 1 to 7. And so they say that they concerning the impact of spaced learning, students' knowledge, knowledge that the physical activity in the middle of the class was important. So they gave this, this was the result, 5.98. And then about the online, because this, I came here today, so I thought it was important to show what happened when they compare online and face-to-face. So the online team-based learning had more benefits, and I'm going to tell you why. Because in online, I could put the groups in different Zoom rooms. And in the big classroom, they were listening to the others. And so this, they had to, three were in front and three were in the back. And so they had to, you know, turn. And so this was just because of the physical space. The online team-based learning was more efficient for the group work, and the face-to-face spaced learning was more engaging, of course. In contrary, when they are dancing and whatever, they prefer to be in the classroom. And consider that I learned better with TBL and spaced learning than with the traditional theoretical classes, and so this was the point. Now, this is based on the university questionnaires. The scale is 1 to 9. And so there are two questions that are asked in every course of the university. And so the ability to stimulate and motivate students for the curricular unit. This is a very good grade. And so this was the first goal of all the project. And so this is really nice. And the creation of a favorable climate for learning and the active participation of students. Now, students' feedback, only good feedbacks. The bad I will leave for the paper. The thing here, for instance, as soon as we enter the classroom, what I feel is that it is more than a class.
It is a space for us to learn, almost like a study room. And now they say the breaks are nice for concentration and divert our minds. So they say also that the questionnaires are very important, that classes were dynamic and stimulated. And this is also very nice, very good source materials, and the professor deeply focused on our education skills and even our lives. And so very nice. Then also, of course, negative things that we try to together change. And I can change along the semester if we can do it. So this is just an example of impact. We have created a web page, a logo. Also, 1 year the project was a COIL, a collaborative online international learning with other colleagues from Brazil. Presentation in several meetings. And then I always give the classes to anyone who asks me. I don't know. They ask
and
me
this
also.
This was awarded
yes.
From
yeah.
This one, right?
Yes, this was awarded in the university. And also, they asked me for a project, European project, for me to prepare a spaced learning interval for the project. And it is very nice because I'm not, you know, any dancer or whatever. But what we did was we made a film. I asked two students and the colleague that helps me, and the four of us made a film, a movie with a dance and with the lettering of the songs, and then we went to the project, we put that like this, and everyone started dancing immediately, so they were not looking at me, they were looking at the screen. And so this was, this is my first students that I had, so always in the with a picture here, and of course acknowledgements to the university that allows me to do this, you know, crazy things, and of course to my colleagues and to my students is the most important, and also my research group, because I leave them alone many times because of the classes, and they are very comprehensive. And at the end, I will leave you with a flash mob, just a little bit we did this year. This is just some seconds.
Everything. I always explain what I do, and if this doesn't match
much. For instance, the problem-based learning classes, they occur during 3 hours. They are practical classes, and we had to put them in practical classes because the practical classes have 3 hours, and sometimes this comes from the rector because not allowed, but then we go there and we explain. And usually, okay, they agree, and so we always have to try to do what we think is best, and then try to explain to them.
Yeah, because I think the present structure that you have here, which is contrary to some countries have, which I know I have some experience on that, forces you to have theoretical classes where the students can miss those classes without any.
Yeah, they can also miss mines because they won't be penalized in terms of, because most. In most of theoretical classes, they can do that, not coming. And
you will get rewards.
Yeah, here they will have a reward. Yeah. And of course, I'm very flexible because, for instance, I always give my students my mobile phone, and once one of them called me and told me I have to miss part of the class because I have to go to my, my city, little place where he lives, to get the prize for being one of the best students in the high school. And of course, this is, it's reasonable.
I don't want to monopolize, it's just one quick question. I was wondering if I went to a class with the students and I told them to dance, what they would thought about it.
The first class is very important. You have to explain
your rationale.
So the first class is the most important class because you have to establish with them some kind of connection. And the most important thing is that I have meetings with a group of students from that class before I play with them and say, oh, be there more a little bit so that one of my sons can do the make dinner for me. So we can talk about other things. So
you try to bond.
Yes, of course. This is the most important.
Thank you.
She's a bit of a psychologist too. Okay, any other questions? No?
Just want to say congratulations. Have you liked the first?
No, if someone wants to come to the classes, you can come. And also in the problem-based learning, if you want, talk to me, and this semester I will not give any classes because I'm in sabbatical, but next semester.
Not but because I'm on sabbatical, I can have more time to.
No, but if they want to come to my class.
Okay. And Margarida was the first awarded for the best pedagogical practices in the University of Aveiro, which we attributed this year, so.
It's nice because it gives you some money that you can spend with students in the way you want. So one of the things I bought was the t-shirts, and all of them have a t-shirt with the name of the project, and this also is very important.
Okay, thank you again.
Okay, thank you.
Also, I don't know if Dorota, are you here? I don't know.
So thank you a lot for being here. Indeed, it was I'm very happy because I think we choose very good speakers this day. And I want to thank also to my colleagues from the University of Aveiro that helped me in the organization of this event. And I hope that you are, for me, I am inspired to change some things in my, I teach mathematics, to try to change my way of teaching. I also use Padlet and a flipped classroom, but I have to use more ICT tools to engage more of the students, I think so.
Yeah, and I think this is important for creating these communities of practice, because we are all interested in doing better, and we can share and talk with each other to do so. So that's very important to note that we are not alone in this. So
thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
And thanks to all the speakers. An email with because we need this data for our final report. We will send you a very 5 minutes survey about your opinion about this event. It is very important. I can ask you to fill this week if it is possible. I think it's 5 minutes. I will send today 2 or 3 hours the link of the survey. And also, do you want to share the about?
I'll share it with you, and then you can
yes, but about
the color?
Yes.
Yeah, I mentioned this collaborative platform. Natalia will send you the
in the same email, I will send everything, okay?
So you can create groups even in your own university, you can do it there. And you can check other groups who are sharing.
Thank you. Good. Niall, just you have to feel. Yes.
If you could just pass by the desk.